Chapter 1. Introduction. In the gradual transformation of the old world of classical antiquity into the world into which the statesmen of today must deal, no man played a greater part than Charles the Great, King of the Franks and Emperor of Rome. The sharp lines of demarcation which we often draw between period and period, and which are useful as helps to memory, have not for the most part had any real existence in history, for in the world of men, as in the development of the material universe, it is true that uniformity rather than cataclysm is the rule. Natura non vadit per saltum. Still, there are some great landmarks, such as the foundation of Constantinople, Alaric's capture of Rome, the hegira of Mohammed, the discovery of America, the Reformation, and the French Revolution, which have no merely artificial existence. We can see that the thoughts of the great majority of civilized men were suddenly forced into a different channel by such events, that after they had occurred, men hoped for other benefits and feared other dangers than they had looked for before these events took place. And such a changeful moment in the history of the world was undoubtedly the life of the great ruler, who is generally spoken of as Charlemagne, and preeminently the year 800, when he was crowned as emperor at Rome. When Charles appeared upon the scene, the Roman Empire, at least as far as Western Europe was concerned, had been for more than three centuries slowly dying. An event to which allusion has just been made, the capture of Rome by Alaric in 410, had dealt the great world empire a mortal blow. And yet, so tough was its constitution, so deeply was the thought engraven even on the hearts of its most turbulent enemies, Rome is the rightful mistress of the world, that it seemed as if that world empire could not die. The Visigoth, the Ostrogoth, the Vandal, the Burgundian, the Lombard, coming forth from the immemorial solitude of their forests, streamed over the cities and the vineyards of the Mediterranean lands, and erected therein their rude state systems, their barbaric sovereignties. But even in framing their uncouth national codes, they were forced to use the language of Rome. In government, they could not dispense with the official machinery of the empire. In religious affairs above all, they found themselves always face to face with men to whom the city by the Tiber was still Roma Caput Mundi. Hence, in all these new barbarian kingdoms that arose on the ruins of the empire, there was a certain feeling of precariousness and unrest, a secret fear that the power which had come into being so strangely and so unexpectedly would in a moment vanish away, and that the Roman Augustus would assert himself once more as supreme over the nations, to borrow a phrase from the controversies of a much later date. The Visigothic and Burgundian and Lombard kings were obviously kings de facto. But there was a latent consciousness in the minds of their subjects, perhaps in their own also, that they were not kings de jure. Had the Italian peninsula been less easily accessible by way of the Julian Alps, or had Rome been situated in as strong a position as Constantinople, it is possible that this secret belief in her rightful predominance might have won back for a Roman emperor the dominion over Europe which was in fact wielded for a time by the Roman popes. But the virtual transference of the seat of empire from the Tiber to the Bosphorus, which was the result of the foundation of the new Rome and the frequent successful sieges of the old Rome, prevented the Roman emperor from thus reasserting himself. There were jealousies between Rome and Constantinople already, before the end of the 4th century, and when, under Justinian, the empire made its wonderful efforts to recover the ground which it had lost in Africa, in Italy, and in Spain, though these reconquests were effected in the name of a Roman Augustus, it was felt, and often loudly asserted, that the armies which fought under the imperial standards were Greek rather than Roman. Thus, through all the kingdoms of the West, even while the emperor enthroned at Constantinople was looked upon as in some sense the legitimate monarch of the world, the old deep-rooted hostility between East and West also made itself felt, and it was becoming every day more improbable that the Western lands should ever be brought under the rule of a Byzantine Caesar. Ere the long, slow agony which I have called the death of Rome was completed, the world was startled by that outbreak of fierce Semitic monotheism which is associated with the name of Mohammed. In 622, rather more than two centuries after Alaric's capture of Rome, Mohammed escaped from Mecca to Medina, and in this retreat of his, the followers of his faith in succeeding ages have rightly seen the beginning of his career of spiritual conquest, wherefore they date all their events from the midnight journey of a fugitive, even as the other great Oriental faith has taken for its landmark the birth of a little child in a stable. Before Mohammed's death in 632, the career of Saracen conquest had begun. Ere the close of the 7th century, Syria, Persia, Egypt, North Africa were torn from the empire of the Caesars and obeyed the rule of the Caliph. In 711, Europe saw the first breach made in its defenses when the great Iberian Peninsula, all save a few mountain glens in the remote north, was captured by the Moors, and Mecca took the place of Jerusalem or Rome as the spiritual center of gravity for Spain. The turbaned invaders crossed the Pyrenees. In 725, they penetrated as far as Autun, only 150 miles from Paris. Though defeated by Charles Martel, the grandfather of Charlemagne, in the great battle of Poitiers, the Moors remained encamped on the soil of that which we now call France. Narbonne was in their possession at the time of the birth of Charlemagne, and remained so during the years of his boyhood, till won back for Christendom by his father in 759. In the east of Europe, the Avars still hung menacingly over the Italian and Illyrian lands. A people allied to the Huns, they occupied the mid-Danubian region, which had been the seat of the barbarian empire of Attila, and though their power had declined somewhat from that which they wielded in the 7th century, it was still a serious danger to civilization. As we shall see, however, the barbarous and heathen Saxons in the lands between the lower Rhine and the Elbe, representing the Teutonic spirit in its fiercest and most stubborn moods, represented an even more formidable obstacle to that remodeling of Europe in the likeness of the old Roman Empire, which was the aim of the great statesman with whose life we have to deal. Such, very briefly, was the aspect of affairs when Charles the Great, the descendant of many mayors of the palace and of one king, found himself with the power of the Frankish nation collected in his sole right hand, controller of the destinies of Western Europe. Without going too far into the times preceding his accession, something in order to explain his position must be said, both as to the Frankish nation and the Arnulfing family. In the northeast of Gaul dwelt, in the latter part of the 5th century after Christ, a confederacy of German tribes called the Salian Franks, occupying the districts known in later days as Flanders, Artois, and Picardy. Farther south was the strong and warlike tribe of the Ripuarian Franks, whose territory stretched along the banks of the Rhine from Mainz to Köln, and along the Moselle from Koblenz to Metz. Salians and Ripuarians recognized a loose tie of kinship between them, but there was no strong feeling of unity, even in the subdivision of the two nations. Both Salians and Ripuarians had many petty kings, and there were frequent civil wars between them. In this state of things, one of these petty kings, Clovis, the Salian Frank, began to reign at Tournai in 481, being then 15 years of age. When he died in the year 511, after 45 years of life and 30 of sovereignty, he had made himself sole master of all Frankish men, and had subdued to his dominion 3/4 of France and a great block of territory in southwestern Germany. Let us briefly recapitulate these conquests, omitting the wars in which the other Frankish princes, whether Salian or Ripuarian, went down before him. In 486 he overthrew the Roman governor Syagrius, who had set up some sort of independent kingship at Soissons. This conquest gave Clovis the provinces afterwards known as Champagne and Lorraine. In 496 he defeated the Alemanni in a great battle, the ultimate result of which was the annexation of the wide district on the right bank of the Rhine known in the Middle Ages as Swabia, comprising in terms of modern geography Alsace, Baden, Württemberg, the western part of Bavaria, and the northern part of Switzerland. The well-timed conversion to Christianity and to the Catholic form of Christianity, which followed this victory, facilitated the next great conquest of Clovis. In the year 507, he went forth to war against Alaric, king of the Visigoths, defeated and slew him, and thus added Aquitaine, that large and fertile region which lies between the Loire and the Pyrenees, to his dominions. 4 years after this, he died, but in the next generation, between 524 and 534, his sons conquered Burgundy, and thus added to their father's kingdom the whole valley of the Rhone, from its source to its mouth, except the narrow but rich land of Provence, which was retained by the Ostrogothic kings of Italy for a few years longer. But in 536, this also became Frankish. Contemporaneously with the conquest of Burgundy proceeded the conquest of Thuringia, the fair region in the heart of Germany which still bears that name, and the establishment of the overlordship of the Franks over the nation of the Bavarians, whose country stretched from the Danube across the Alps into the valley of the Adige and up to the very gates of Italy. The date of this last addition to the Frankish dominions cannot be precisely ascertained, but may be stated approximately at the year 535. It will be seen from this brief summary how rapidly the tide of Frankish conquest rose almost to the same high water mark which it maintained at the time of the birth of Charlemagne. In 50 years from the first appearance of Clovis as a warrior, the Franks have subdued the whole of modern France, except the little strip of Languedoc, the Low Countries, Switzerland, and all Germany, as far as the Elbe and the mountains of Bohemia, except Hanover and a part of Westphalia, which is occupied by the untamed and still heathen Saxons. Such a monarchy even now would be the greatest power in Europe. In the 6th century, with Spain weakened by the estrangement between Arians and Catholics, with Italy torn by strife between the empire and its barbarian occupants, with Britain still in utter chaos, nibbled at but not devoured by her Anglo-Saxon invaders, the kingdom of the Franks, when united and at peace within itself, was the strongest power in Europe, with the two doubtful exceptions of the kingdom of the savage Avars and the tottering fabric of the Roman Empire. But the years in which the Frankish kingdom was thus united and at peace with itself were few. It had been built up by the ferocious energy of one man and his sons. It was hardly, in any true sense of the word, national, and he and his descendants treated it as an estate rather than as a country, partitioned and repartitioned it in a way which wasted its strength and ruined its chances of attaining to political unity. The comparison may seem a strange one, but in the personal, non-national character of his policy, the first Frankish king reminds one of the latest French conqueror. The career of Clovis may be illustrated by that of Napoleon. Both men emphatically fought for their own hands. Both were more intent on massing great countries under their sway than on really assimilating the possessions which they had already acquired. Both in different ways made or tried to make the Catholic Church an instrument of their ambition, and both seem to have looked upon Europe, or so much of it as they could acquire, as a big estate to be divided among their children or relations. There is no need here to dwell upon the perplexing details of the division of the kingdom of Clovis among his sons and grandsons. We perceive a tendency to regard the northeastern portion of the realm, especially that conquered from Syagrius, as the true kernel of the kingdom, and therefore, widely as the dominions of the brothers stretch asunder, their capitals, Metz, Orléans, Soissons, Paris, all lie comparatively near to one another, all probably within the ring-fence of the Syagrian kingdom. But there is also a tendency to fall asunder into four great divisions. Burgundy and Aquitaine, though they do not formally resume their independence, are often seen as separate kingdoms under a Frankish king. But the more important division, the more fateful rivalry, separates the two northern kingdoms, which eventually receive the names of Neustria and Austrasia. In Neustria, which contained the regions of Flanders, Normandy, Champagne, and central France as far as the Loire, there was doubtless a very large Gallo-Roman population, though its numbers may not have so enormously preponderated over those of the Teutonic immigrants as in Aquitaine and Burgundy. The Roman language and some remains of Roman culture survived here in Neustria and were preparing the ground for the formation of the medieval kingdom of France. Austrasia, on the other hand, the territory of the Rhine and the Moselle, seems to have remained essentially German. The Latin speech in this country must have been confined to ecclesiastics and a few of the more cultivated courtiers. It can never have been the speech of the people. And though here we must speak rather by conjecture than by proof, it is probable that the old Germanic institutions of the Hundred and the Gau survived here in greater vigor than on the alien soil of Romanized Gaul. It was also through the rulers of Austrasia that the connection, frail and precarious as it often might be, was kept up between the Frankish monarchy and the great semi-independent duchies of the Thuringians, the Alemanni, and the Bavarians. Thus already, in the fissure between the western and eastern portions of the Merovingian kingdom, we see the rift, premonitory of that mighty chasm, which now separates the great states of France and Germany. Chapter 2, Part 1, Early Mayors of the Palace. The historical student who visits in thought the nursery of modern European states, the period from 500 to 800 of the Christian era, finds with amused surprise how many of the features familiar to him in their weather-beaten old age he can trace in the faces of those baby kingdoms. Gothic Spain, with its manifold councils, its ecclesiastical intolerance, and its bitter persecutions of the Jews, is the anticipation of the Spain of the Ferdinands and the Philips. Italy, cleft in sunder by the patrimony of St. Peter, and with the undying hostility between the Pope and the Lombard king, presages the very conflict which is now being waged between the Vatican and the Quirinal. England, notwithstanding all her early elements of confusion and mismanagement, clings desperately to her one great saving institution of the Witan, and thus travails in birth with the future Parliament. And even so France, under the Merovingian kings, is the land of centralized government, which, though strong and imposing in theory, repeatedly shows itself weak and insufficient in practice from the incapacity of the governing brain to perform the manifold functions assigned to it by destiny. As far as we can see, Clovis and his immediate successors wielded a power which was practically unlimited. The checks which the German nations from the time of Tacitus downwards had imposed on the authority of their kings had almost entirely disappeared before the overmastering power of the great Salian chief who had united the whole of Gaul under his sway, and who was continually reminded by his friends, the Christian bishops, how high had been the throne and how heavy the scepter of the Roman Augustus in that very region. The well-known story of the vase of Soissons illustrates at once the German memories of freedom and the Merovingian mode of establishing a despotism. As a battle comrade, the Frankish warrior protests against Clovis receiving an ounce beyond his due share of spoils. As a battle leader, Clovis rebukes his henchmen for the dirtiness of his accoutrements and cleaves his skull to punish him for his independence. There can be little doubt that it was the influence of Roman and ecclesiastical ideas which tended to exalt the rude chiefs of the Salian tribes into their later position of practically despotic monarchs surrounded by a crowd of fawning flatterers and servile courtiers. The effect of this exaltation on the royal house itself was disastrous. Merovingian royalty flowered too soon and faded early. Clovis himself was short-lived, dying, as we have seen, at the age of 45. But two or three generations later, the career of the kings, his descendants, was of far more portentous brevity. Nothing is more common than to find a Merovingian king who is a father at 15 or even earlier, and who dies, not always by a violent death, under 30. Let us take a few of the lives of the later kings as an illustration. Dagobert I, who is a sort of patriarch among them, dies at 38. His son, Clovis II, at 24. Of the sons of this latter king, Clotaire III dies at 18, Childeric II at 20, Theodoric III actually lives to the age of 38, but of his sons, one dies at 13 and another at 18. And so on, with many other names that might be quoted. It was evidently by their vices that these hapless do-nothing kings were hurried to such early graves. Every student of the pages of Gregory of Tours knows the dreary picture of morals and of social life which is here presented. The coarseness of the barbarian without his rough fidelity, the voluptuousness of the Gallo-Roman noble without his culture. Even as we see at the present day in the contact of two civilizations or of two faiths, notably in the contact of Christianity and Mohammedanism, that the men whose position places them on the borders of the two are apt to display the vices of both and the virtues of neither, so was it with the Frankish nobles and bishops of Gaul in the 6th and 7th centuries, and so emphatically was it with their head, the Frankish king who reigned at Metz or Orléans or Paris. Immersed in his swinish pleasures, with his constitution ruined by his early excesses, what could the sickly youth, the Childebert or Clotaire of the day, do to overtake the mass of business which the administration of the realm, with its highly centralized mechanism, imposed upon him? He could not do it all, and in practice he did nothing, and sank easily and perhaps happily into the condition of the roi fainéant. Dagobert I, who died in 638, is the last Merovingian king who displays some royal energy and strength of purpose. After him, for more than a century, a series of pageant kings pass before us, Clovises and Theodorics and Chilperics, whose names history refuses to remember, but whose pitiable condition is represented to us by a few vivid touches from the hand of Einhard, the biographer of Charlemagne. He describes to us how the Merovingian king, seated in his chair of state, received the ambassadors of foreign powers and repeated, parrot-like, the answers which he had been taught to give, how he traveled through the land in a wagon drawn by a yoke of oxen with a clownish herdsman for his charioteer, and thus made his appearance, when his presence was required, at the palace or at the yearly assemblies of the people, but how, for the greater part of the year, he abode at one small villa in the country, living on its produce, eked out by a scanty grant from his prime minister, and having in truth nothing that he could call his own save his royal title, his long flowing hair, and his pendulous beard, which were the marks of his kingly state. Doubtless it is not only the constitutional sovereign who is obliged to content himself with only a small share of actual power. The despot also, if he wishes to have any enjoyment of life, must leave much to be done by his ministers, who, whatever show of deference they may yield to his judgment, will practically decide for themselves the great mass of administrative questions that come before them. Thus Louis XIII had his Richelieu, thus the Sultan of Turkey has his Grand Vizier, thus, till our own day, the Mikado of Japan had his Shogun, whom European travelers wrote about by his Chinese title of Tycoon. The relation of these last regents to the royal dynasty, in whose name they ruled for many centuries, while depriving them of every shred of actual power, seems to furnish the closest parallel in all history to the relation of the Frankish majordomus to the Merovingian king. The origin and early stages of the growth of the power of the mayor of the palace, our usual English translation of the title majordomus, forms one of the most difficult subjects in Frankish history. Perhaps the greatest difficulty is to understand why it is that no Teutonic name of an office, which was certainly not Roman but Teutonic, should have survived in history. An opinion which has found some powerful supporters is that the office was the same which was called by the Germans seneschal, the oldest servant in the palace, and that as the last part of this word denoted a servile condition, the more respectful Latin term majordomus was adopted instead. This opinion is, however, as powerfully opposed, and certainly the fact that both majordomus and seneschalcus are found in the same documents as titles of apparently different offices seems to throw a doubt upon its correctness. But whatever the origin of the name, it is pretty clear that the mayor of the palace was originally but the chief domestic of the king, he to whom it appertained to order the ceremonies of the court, to rule the royal pages, probably to superintend the repairs of the royal dwelling. Hence, not only reigning kings, but queens dowager, and even princesses, had their majoris domus, and it even seems probable that one king might have several mayors, each superintending one of his various palaces. This, however, is only true of the early days of the mayoralty. As chief man of business to an imperfectly educated, care-encumbered, pleasure-loving king, the mayor of the palace took one burden after another off the royal shoulders, and at the same time drew one source of power after another into his own hands. Especially at a pretty early period of his career, he seems to have acquired the supreme control of the royal treasury, superintending the collection of the taxes, administering the royal domains, eventually acquiring the power of granting those beneficia, or as they would be called in the language of a later day, those fiefs, by which, on the one hand, the royal property was so seriously diminished, but, on the other hand, the friendship of an important nobleman might, at a crisis of the mayor's fortunes, be so easily secured. From the first appearance of the majordomus in Frankish history till the year when the last majordomus was crowned king of the Franks, thereby absorbing the lower office into the higher, a period of about 170 years intervened, and during that long space of time, these anomalous functionaries assume very different shapes and exercise their powers in very different ways. Sometimes, especially in the earlier years of this period, they are the vigorous upholders of the rights of the crown against a turbulent aristocracy, and then the mayor of the palace seems to anticipate Richelieu. Sometimes they appear at the head of the aristocracy and force their way, almost in spite of the king, into the palace from which they take their title. And then they remind us of the Guises and the Condé of a later day. In Neustria and Burgundy, no mayor of the palace who arises there succeeds in making his office hereditary. In Austrasia, there is a very early tendency toward hereditary succession in the office, and five generations of able men, wielding its growing powers, become at last in name as well as in fact supreme. It is out of the question to give here any detailed description of the development of the mayoralty of the palace during that space of nearly two centuries, but one or two illustrations drawn from the history of the times may show what manner of men the mayors were and how they wielded their power. In the 10th year of the reign of Theodoric II, king of Burgundy, says the unlettered chronicler who goes by the name of Fredegarius, at the instigation of Brunechildis and by order of Theodoric, Protadius is appointed mayor of the palace, a man of great cleverness and energy in all that he undertook, but fierce was his injustice against private persons. Straining too far the rights of the treasury, he strove to fill it and to enrich himself by ingenious attacks on private property. Wherever he found a man of noble descent, all such he strove to humble, that more might be found who could assume the dignity which he had seized. By these and other exactions, the work of a man too clever for his office, he succeeded in making enemies of all the chief men in Burgundy. The chronicler then goes on to describe how Protadius stirred up strife between Theodoric and his brother, Theudebert, king of Austrasia, whom he declared to be no true king's son, but son of a gardener by an adulterous intercourse with the queen. The Burgundian army marched forth and encamped at a place called Caratiacum, but there the king was advised by his leudes, retainers, to make peace with Theudebert. Protadius, however, exhorted them one by one to join battle. Theudebert was encamped not far off with his army. Then all the army of Theodoric, finding a suitable opportunity, rushed upon Protadius, saying that it was better that one man should die than that the whole army should be sent into danger. Now Protadius was sitting in the tent of King Theodoric, playing at draughts with the arch-physician Peter, and when the army had surrounded him on every side, and Theodoric was held back by his leudes to prevent his going thither, he sent Uncilenus to announce to the army his word of command that they should desist from their plots against Protadius. Uncilenus straightway bore to the army this message: "Thus orders our lord Theodoric that Protadius be slain." Rushing in therefore and entering the king's tent from all sides with drawn swords, they slay Protadius. Covered with confusion, Theodoric made an involuntary peace with his brother Theudebert, and both armies returned to their own homes. After the decease of Protadius in the 11th year of Theodoric, Claudius is appointed to the office of mayordomus. He was a Roman by descent, a prudent man, a pleasant storyteller, energetic in all things, given to patience, abounding in counsel, learned in letters, full of faith, desiring friendship with all men. Taking warning by the example of those who had gone before him, he bore himself gently and patiently in his high office. But this only hindrance had he, that he was burdened with too great fatness of body. In the 12th year of Theodoric, at the instigation of Brunechildis, Uncilenus, who had by his treacherous words brought about the death of Protadius, had one of his feet cut off, was despoiled of his possessions, and reduced to poverty. At the instigation of the same queen, Volphos, the patrician who had been consenting to the death of Protadius, was killed at the villa of Foriniacum by order of Theodoric, and Ricomerus, a man of Roman descent, succeeded him in the patriciate. These events may be taken as a sample of the working of the institution of the majordomus in Neustria and Burgundy for the greater part of a century. We see a king becoming more and more helpless in the presence of the nobles and clergy whom he and his predecessors have enriched. Theodoric II is not personally a fainéant king, but he cannot prevent murder being committed in his name. We see a majordomus intent on refilling the royal treasury, and probably not scrupulous as to the means by which he employs for that purpose, nor afraid of enriching himself at the same time as his master. We see a grasping and turbulent aristocracy, made up of courtiers and ecclesiastics, who are determined to keep what they have got from the crown, and to whom both the lawful and the lawless acts of the prime minister on behalf of his impoverished master render that minister equally odious. The aristocracy bide their time. When the army is assembled on the field, they appeal to the old Teutonic spirit of almost democratic independence and slay their enemy in defiance of the king's authority. A sleek and supple Gallo-Roman takes the place of the murdered mayor, and in his placid corpulence gives up the struggle, letting things drift as they will. But the vengeance of the palace slumbers not, and in time the aristocratic murderers of the prime minister are themselves cut off by hands as lawless as their own. Such is Merovingian France in the 7th century after Christ. I have tried to indicate the general character of the majordomat in the two western kingdoms of Gaul. In Austrasia, though probably the chief functions of the office are the same, its holder seems to look in a different direction, and certainly arrives at a different end. The Neustrian and Burgundian mayors of the palace are generally striving for the rights of the crown against the aristocracy. In Austrasia, they are more often found at the head of the aristocracy and opposed to the crown. In the western kingdoms, we see indications that the majordomus was often a man of humble origin, and that this was part of the grievance of the aristocracy against him. In Austrasia, he is generally a man who, by his birth and possessions, takes a foremost place in the realm, independently of his official rank. Hence, and from the fact that the office was held in Austrasia by a long succession of able men in the same family, arises the distinction already alluded to, that in Austrasia the majordomat becomes hereditary, and that it never acquired that character in Neustria. Lastly, and this difference is perhaps related to most of the others which I have named, as cause is related to effect, the western kingdoms seem at this time to have been always looked on as containing the heart and center of the Frankish dominion. Thus, when a Frankish king had been ruling in Austrasia with Metz for his capital, if by the death of a father or brother he succeeded to the throne of Neustria, he generally migrated westwards to Paris or Soissons, sometimes sending a son or a younger brother to rule in Austrasia, sometimes seeking to rule it from Paris. Now it is clear that there was a strong and growing feeling in Austrasia, which was already beginning to be stirred by some of the same sentiments as the Germany of today, that it would not be ruled from Neustria, the ancestress of France. A Merovingian king, the descendant of the Salian Clovis, it would endure, but he must rule not through Neustria, but through Austrasian instruments. This feeling of national German independence was represented and championed by the mayors of the palace of the line of Arnulf and Pippin, and to their history we now turn. The ancestors of Charlemagne first emerge into the light of history at the time of the downfall of Queen Brunechildis. No student of Frankish history can ever forget the tragic figure of that queen or her lifelong duel with her ignoble and treacherous sister-in-law, Fredegundis. While Brunechildis was still in early womanhood,
576,
came reverses, the murder of her husband, imprisonment, a second marriage, separation from the young husband whom she had so strangely chosen, followed by his death at the bidding of Fredegundis. Meanwhile, she returned to Austrasia and ruled there for a time, first in the name of a son, then of a grandson. Driven from thence in 600, by the turbulent aristocracy whose power she had striven to quell, she escaped to Burgundy and governed it for 13 years in the name of her grandson, Theodoric. We have just seen her instigating the appointment of Protadius as mayor of the palace and the punishment of his murderers. All through these later years of her life, the once fascinating and beautiful woman seems like a lioness at bay. If Mary, Queen of Scots, had escaped from Fotheringay, even so could we imagine her grown gray and hard and cruel, confronting John Knox and the Scottish lords. Her grandsons perished early. Theodoric renewed the war with Theudebert, defeated and slew him, but died himself at the Austrasian capital in the year 613. And now we're left of the race of Clovis, only the four infant sons of Theodoric II and their distant relation, Clotaire of Neustria, son of the hated Fredegundis. War was inevitable. Which would prevail, the old lioness fighting for her cubs or the whelp of Neustria? At this crisis, the adhesion of two Austrasian nobles to the party of Clotaire decided the day in his favor. These two Austrasian nobles were Pippin of London and Arnulf, afterwards Bishop of Metz. Pippin of London, so-called, had large possessions in the country between the Meuse and the Moselle, stretching in an easterly direction toward the Rhine, including the forest of the Ardennes, and apparently including also the city of Aquis Granum, which was one day to be the home of Charlemagne. Pippin was born about 585, and was therefore somewhere about 30 years of age when war broke out between Brunechildis and Clotaire. His friend and contemporary Arnulf, born of a noble and wealthy Frankish family, had received a better education, apparently, than fell to the lot of most of his class, and on the recommendation of the sub-king Gundolf, possibly mayor of the palace, had been taken into the service of Theudebert, who had assigned to him the government of 6 provinces. He had married a girl of noble birth, by whom he had 2 sons, Clodulf and Ansegisel. The latter was the ancestor of Charlemagne. It was, as we are told, by the secret advice of these 2 men and other nobles of Austrasia that Clotaire invaded the kingdom. However strong might be their disinclination to the rule of a Neustrian king, their determination not to again submit to the hateful regimen of a woman, and that woman, their old foe, Brunechildis, was even stronger. The folly of the old queen, who was at the same time secretly plotting against the life of her Burgundian mayor of the palace, Varnacar, aided their designs. When it came to the decision of battle, the soldiers who should have defended the cause of the young king and his great-grandmother turned their backs without striking a blow. Clotaire had only to pursue and to capture the little princes and their ancestress. One of the princes escaped and was never heard of more. Another was spared as being the godson of Clotaire. 2 were put to death. The aged Brunechildis was, we are told, tortured for 3 days by the son of her old rival, Fredegundis, led through the camp, seated on a camel, then tied by her hair, by 1 foot and 1 arm, to a most vicious horse, and dashed to pieces by his furious career. Such were the tender mercies of a Merovingian king. Chapter 2, Part 2, early mayors of the palace. This first appearance of Pippin and Arnulf on the stage of history is not a noble one, yet of actual disloyalty or ingratitude they were probably not guilty, since to Theudebert, the victim of the resentment of Brunechildis, rather than to the family of Theodoric, his vanquisher and murderer, they owed allegiance and gratitude. The subsequent career of the two nobles, however, is more to their credit. In the year after the overthrow of Brunechildis, the See of Metz having fallen vacant, there was a general outcry among the people that none were so gifted to fill it as Arnulf, the domesticus and conciliarius of the king. There was, on his part, the usual tearful protestation of unfitness and unwillingness, but the curtain fell on his acceptance of the episcopal dignity. His biographer tells the story of his 3 days' fastings, his hair shirt, his boundless hospitality to poor vagrants, to monks, and to other travelers. We perceive, however, that he had not wholly lost his interest in state affairs, for in the year 624 he, with his friend Pippin, the majordomus, procured the disgrace of a certain nobleman named Crodoald, who was charged with having abused the king's favor to his own enrichment, and the spoliation of the estates of other Austrasians. In the next year, too, when Dagobert I, son of Clotaire, who had been sent to rule over a shorn and diminished Austrasia, met his father near Paris and had a sharp contention with him over the narrow limits of his kingdom, it was Bishop Arnulf who, at the head of the other bishops and nobles, succeeded in reconciling father and son. It seems that Arnulf had for years cherished a desire to withdraw from the world, but when he mentioned this project to Dagobert, the young king, who greatly valued his counsels, was so incensed that he swore he would cut off the heads of his two sons if he dared to leave the court. "My sons' lives," said the intrepid prelate, "are in the hands of God. Your own life will not last long if you slay the innocent." On this, the passionate young Merovingian drew his sword and was about to attack Arnulf, who, not heeding the wrath of the king, said, "What are you doing, most miserable of men? Would you repay evil for good? Here I am ready for death in obedience to his commands, who gave me life and who died for me." The nobles besought the king not to give the bishop the crown of martyrdom. The queen appeared upon the scene, and in a few moments she and Dagobert were groveling at Arnulf's feet, beseeching forgiveness for the king's offense, and declaring that he should go when and whither he would. So, after an episcopate of 15 years, in 629 Arnulf retired into the recesses of the Vosges mountains, accompanied by one friend, Romaric, once a courtier like himself, who had gone before him into the hermit life, and who, like him, attained to the honors of saintship. The death of Arnulf is generally placed in 640, but we have, in truth, no exact information as to the date. We only know that Romaric survived him, and that the body of the now canonized prelate was brought with great pomp to the city of Metz, by order of his successor to the see, and was there interred in the Church of the Holy Apostles, which has ever since borne his name. The Vita Arnulfi, from which these facts have been taken, appears to have been the work of a contemporary, doubtless a much admiring contemporary, and we need not therefore here suspect that tendency to flatter Charlemagne by magnifying the greatness of his ancestors, which has undoubtedly colored the histories of some of the members of his family. It is certainly an interesting fact that a saint should have been the paternal ancestor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.